Thank you. Good afternoon. God bless you. You notice there should be five sets of books here. This is the first one. It's the pattern, and this is the pattern of the tabernacle. The beauty about this is that God knew that man would change the word of God. So he drew a picture, and nobody changed the picture. They didn't know what to do. They wouldn't know how to change the picture. So they left the picture in the Bible, and the picture has in symbolism every scripture that is in your Bible. And if you get a doctrine and you don't know whether this doctrine is right or wrong, you check the picture. And the picture will tell you. For instance, I give you an example. We were in Miami, and a man came in with a new doctrine, and it was the father ministry. The husband ministry. But the ministry were the husband of the church. And the Lord spoke to me immediately and said, nobody, no human being can overshadow his people to bring forth Christ. Every seed brings forth after its own kind. If you plant corn, you must get corn. And so the minister could not bring forth Christ in you. Only Christ can bring forth Christ. And so the minister's duty is to introduce you to Christ and to help you to remain in Christ so that Christ bring forth Christ in you. For that's the whole idea behind it. We could start anywhere. I want you to be very comfortable with me. If you see there's something I say and you don't understand it, just raise your hand. Stop me. Let's go over it. And I want you to talk back. I don't know if you're used to having preachers that tell you must talk back to them, but I want you to talk back. I would like everybody to understand everything that I say by the time we leave through this door. So relax. I used to be a teacher once. So don't be afraid of me. I would like you to have a copy of each of these books. But we don't sell anything. No strings attached. I don't like to say it's free because there's an ulterior motive in every book. The book wants to change you. The book wants to tell you something. So we so badly want to tell you what God has told me, so we give you the book free. So it's not really free because you're going to pay for it, in that you're going to become a Christian. Praise God. Well, before I go, I can just give you a synopsis of what I am. I used to be an accountant. From the time I left school, I went into accountancy, and it was a good one. But one day God spoke to me. And when you hear people say God speak to you, I always thought that, well, God, you know, they hear something in their minds or something like that. Sometimes it is like that. But the way God spoke to me was in a voice. He spoke to me personally. I was young and very violent. I mean, we grew up on the west end of town and we just loved to fight. And I'm sorry for those who have that problem, because it's really a spirit, and a spirit, evil spirit, that must be delivered, them should be delivered from that spirit. But we used to fight, and it came to a point where a friend of mine wanted to fight me. And nobody fight me and survive, and I just was very unhappy about it. I begged him. But the more I beg him, you think it's because I can't fight him. And so I said, the best thing to do is to kill myself. I took the gun and was about to kill myself, and the Lord came into my room and stopped me. And I was shocked. First of all, I never knew there was a, I knew, I heard there was God. I used to go to church and things like that. I was in the choir and everything. But, you know, the word God didn't mean a person who is interested and alive and will talk to you and so on. And so this is one of the reasons we must understand the people of the world, and our friends too, they don't know that there's a living, walking, talking God that loves you and gave his life for you. And he, when we say give his life for you, it means he left his life here so that you could get that same life that he had, and that is in God. And I'm going to show you a little pattern there. And he came into my room and he took away the gun. In other words, inside here, I was shocked to realize that I was going to kill myself. And, you know, people who kill themselves go to hell. In very few cases that people can kill themselves and not go to hell. I don't know if you know that. You are in a college here and a lot of students, and some students commit suicide. Well, what you have done, your bodies are the temple of the living God. God made you for a purpose. God has a purpose for you. And when you kill yourself, you destroy God's purpose. You flaunt God, and you, first of all, you can't repent after you die. So when you kill yourself, the last act you committed was a sin. With wickedness, you can't live. You can't. So most people who kill themselves go to hell. I know one man who killed himself and he didn't go to hell because God brought him back. He took the gas, he turned on the gas stove, put his head over it until all his limbs got stiff and he just fell to the floor, and the gas was filling the room, and Jesus appeared to him. And he said, "Oh God, I'm sorry, I didn't know you were alive and so on, and you would be interested." And he just begged God, "Please God, help me to, I'm going to serve you for the rest of my life." And he said he struggled and struggled until he got to the, he was stiff, he couldn't turn off the stove. So he went to the window and he threw himself against the window and his head hung outside, and that's the way they found him, and he lived. And he became a preacher. I knew him very well, and he preached, and he died the other day, and I'm sure he's gone to be with the Lord. So that's one that had a good name. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about God's whole plan. First of all, he design. That's the first thing. If, for instance, a man who said there's no God, okay? If you have a design, you must have a designer. You cannot have a thing that is intelligently designed without having someone who designed it. So it is design and form. Form, and number three is purpose. There's no designer that goes and works and designs a chair and specially make it into a special form without having a purpose for that chair. So everything that has a design must have a form and have a purpose. If you know of anybody who says there's no God, it's a very simple thing. If the person is intelligent at all and he says there's no God, ask him if there can be a design without a designer. And the designer went further to build a form and a purpose. You see, a car, you don't have to know that there is a factory that makes cars. When the moment you see the car, this car was factory made. You see, so You might not have been to Detroit, you might not have known the Ford factory, yet you can see the Ford, and it's has a certain form. You say, oh, this is a 95 Ford or a 2005 Ford, and this it works. It has a form and it works. So the designer must have a purpose. And so when you ask the person who don't believe in God, okay, look at my body. You think you could make one like this? Who you think made? Huh? It's so simple that a child should know it. Yet I saw the great scientist Sagan, you remember him? He used to say there's no God. And I wish I could talk to the man, because it's so irrational. How could you have such a design, such a form like me, function without a God to make it? Because no man can make a man. And so there it is. We're going to talk about the design, the designer, the form, and the purpose. Now, in my experience, I did not know that God was interested in me or anybody else. I thought, well, I just didn't think, to be honest with you. The world going on, going to hell, everything is going, you know, men are killing one another and all like that. And so I just did not put two and two together. But one day, when God walked through my room door and came in, that's book number one, right? Mm-hmm. In book number one, you'll see that my testimony. He walked through the room door, he came in, I asked him to come, because it was so simple for me. If I had someone who wanted to see me, I would make an appointment to the person. I would expect the person to come at a certain time. Then if I expected that from an ordinary human being, why shouldn't I expect the same from God? If he's God, he made everything to talk. I went that night after he took away the gun. I analyzed the Bible. I went into it. First of all, I wanted to know if God talks to people. Then I wanted to know what type of people would God talk to. Then I wanted to know, would he talk to me? Right? First of all, I went from Genesis, and I was shocked. The first shock I had, after the guy killed his brother, just an outright murder, the first murder on earth, he killed his brother, and he was sassy. Because when God said to him, what have you done? Where is your brother? Am I my brother's keeper? Oh, yes. You know what I mean. And God, afterwards he begged God and said, well, my punishment is more than I can bear. And he said, all right, I'll help you. What? You think God would probably blow him away. That's the picture of God that some of us get. That God would just blow him away because he just killed his child. No, God put a mark on him and said, anywhere you go, I don't want anybody to kill you, since you asked for mercy. You see what I mean? So God spoke to a murderer. I said, well, God spoke to a murderer, he would speak to me. And then going on, I see where Moses murdered the man, buried him in the sand, and God speak to him and help him to get away from Pharaoh. And the pattern right through and through the Bible, you can see the nature of God, that he is love, that he is mercy, that he wants to help us, that he wants to deliver us. And so I analyzed that all through the night, and I got my summary of the whole thing. And in the morning, I said, God, speak to me. It's now 8:00, I must get to work, but I meet you at 4:00. So I made an appointment with this God that had taken away my gun for 4:00. And what do you think happened? At 4:00, I'm sitting down, relaxing on the bed with the Bible in my hand and the door open. And a man pushed his head through and said, "Hi, you are there." First of all, I don't expect God to say hi. That's exactly what he did. He was exactly, from what I know of him, he's a man. And nobody would ever be able to convince me different, because for 7 months I had that coming in, walking, Jesus walking into my room, talking to me, disappeared. He came, when he came to the door, he said, "Hi, you are there." And as I said, you know, he was right behind me, right over my shoulder. And he began to talk. And see here, everything in me, remember now, I tell you, I was a violent man. I love to fight. I just love boxing. I just love to be hit and to, you know, it was in my blood, right? And all that drained out of me, right then and there. I never had such a peace on earth. I didn't know that there was such a peace on earth. Because, you know, even if you lie down resting, your mind is going up and down and so on. And you have a mind that has a perpetual motion. But this time, Jesus just, it's presence. So this is the reason why you must know the difference between God and the devil, because the devil will come and speak like what God. He did it to me one time. You know, he came to my son, and I say, "Yes, Lord." You know, thinking it was God, and it was the devil. So the devil does try to speak like God, but it's a different feeling. Your whole soul responds differently. If the devil come and stand before you, you feel kind of troubled, and you know, you can't feel at peace. And so that's the difference. Anyhow, I'm just saying that. Now, so when he came into my room, he for 7 months, every day, he came in. Now, I sat down there, and he began to talk to me. And all these things that I heard about the Bible, all my animosity, all my anger, everything went. And I said to him, "But what about the 3,000 mistakes in the Bible?" He said, "There are no mistakes in the Bible." I said, "So then, what about this chapter that says, out of your bellies shall flow rivers of living water?" And he just calmly turned the Bible to Ezekiel chapter 47, and he says, "Out of the temple flows the rivers of living waters," and he says, "Your bodies are the temple of the living God." I heard you sing it a while ago, you know, "Your bodies are the temple of the living God." That's the purpose for which God, and the purpose he wants to walk in you. And he wants to talk in you. In you. He wants to be your God. He wants you to be his people. And he wants you to be your God. And he wants to be your God. He wants to walk in you. He wants to talk in you. He wants to be you to be his people. And that is found in about 20 or 30 different places in the Bible. I'll give you the New Testament, which is Hebrews, what is it, Peter? Hebrews 8? 10? You see, that is God's purpose. Now, there's something else, a higher purpose, a greater purpose. And the greater purpose is that in the ages to come, God wants you to be one of the, well, I wouldn't say one of the angels, because you are going to be above angels. You are going to be like Jesus Christ, exactly like how Jesus Christ was after he was resurrected. You have a body, you can eat, you can drink if you want to, you can disappear when you want to, you can be anywhere you want to, and you can manifest as a human being. The only thing you lack is blood. You'll have flesh and bone, and the Spirit of God will be moving through you like the blood. And you will be both human and spirit at the same time. Anybody has any questions about that? All right, we go on then. Now, if you use your form, your body, for anything to thwart the purpose of God, then you destroy God's intentions and you go to hell. Now, you, first of all then, you ask me a question, what is hell? Hell at present, there is a one hell now and a worse hell to come. You know, I wish you'd take notes of these things, because I'll say a lot of things that are not, you won't get it in church, right? There's one hell now, and there's a worse hell to come. The hell that you have now is spirit people, or spirits and people walking up and down in a realm where they can torment one another, and the spirits can enter into other people and walk up and down to and fro, seeking rest, finding none, in a tormented state. But that's not the real hell. The real hell is the lake of fire. What that means is a total separation from God. If God would separate us from him right now, we'd be in hell. Fire would total separation from God. And so the lake of fire is a permanent hell where the devil and his angels will be cast, and where men who don't want God. Now, why does anyone go to hell? Only one reason. Can anybody tell me the reason? Why would a person go to hell? You have any idea?
They didn't accept Jesus as their Savior.
Yes, that's the reason. In other words, it's not because you sin. Because we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God, so nobody would ever go to heaven. But God made a provision and a preparation for sin. And I tell you something more. God could not send you to hell because you sin. Did you know that? God could not send you to hell because you sin. You know why? You were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. You could not help sinning. And if you were born that way and God sent you to hell because you are a sinner, then it would mean that wasn't logical for God to do. You see? Now, that's why when we come to things like homosexuality, the scientists and the homosexuals are saying that they are homosexuals because God made them so. Now, God did not make them. How do I know? Because if God made them so, he could not send them to hell for being homosexual. You follow me? You want to know then, how did God make you? God made one being. And the one being was male and female. Now, you can ask me for scriptures for these things anywhere along, because if I stop to give you scriptures for everything I say, then we wouldn't make it for today. You see, so God made man, and the man had two sexes in him. He was both male and female. And God separated him, the two beings, and took out the womb and all the female parts and put it in another being and call it female. For instance, you sisters here, you won't be sisters in heaven. When your change come, you won't be ladies, you know. Did you ever think of it? You won't be men either. There you will be like the angels, neither male nor female. In other words, we only need maleness and femaleness because of this world. God wants us to procreate the species, and that's, angels can't procreate. They can't make other angels. We can make children. And whatever is in your heart and in your mind, the way you think, your children come out, think the same way. And you give them your body and you give them your soul. I'm sure you didn't know that. And if you give your kid your body and your soul, it means that somehow you become responsible for your kids to lead them in the right way, because it's a part of you that you have given to them, and God made it that way that we can multiply. All right, now then, before I go from the design, form, and purpose here, are there any questions that you want to ask, or do you want to store up the questions for the last? If it's fresh in your mind, if something doesn't seem right to you, if you're thinking, well, what about so-and-so? You can ask those questions now, and we will deal with it right here before we take it off the board and go to something else. Any thoughts that come to you that would, God, that the design proves the designer? Anybody, any atheist, anyone who says he's an atheist, ask him, how did he come about? If he tells you he came about by evolution, it's a nonsense. And I tell you why it's nonsense. If evolution ever started to make a human being, all these thousands of years, we haven't seen one that would come forth without a parent. Huh? Don't you understand? Once evolution starts to make human beings, what would have stopped it from making human beings? It still makes jellyfish. It still makes sharks. It still makes lions and tigers, dogs and cats. Huh? I mean, why wouldn't we see these coming forth without parents? All of a sudden, a man would appear and he has no mother or father. He evolved from some animal. It's nonsense. And I would love to meet a professor who believes in evolution because it's total nonsense, you know. And so another thing people tell you, they don't have any faith. It's not true. Everybody is endowed with a certain amount of faith, enough faith to help him to claim God and to claim Jesus as a Savior. And I tell you why. He goes and he buys a ticket on some airplane to go to New York. And he calls New York and said, I will be there at such and such a time. Please meet me at the airport. You ever look at a plane? It has millions of parts, screws, just little screws and things that keep it together. And any one of those could be slack or could back out or something could happen to that engine or something up in the air. You know? And yet, he will have enough faith in those people who made that plane. He has enough faith in the pilot to sit down there and don't get crazy and just crash the plane. He has enough faith in all the thousand circumstances that could stop him from being in New York. And yet, he called somebody and told him, I'll be there. So that shows that there's a certain amount of faith that human beings have, and they have it in natural things. You know, you are two-thirds spirit. I'm not fooled by you sitting before me to believe that you are what I am seeing. That's under the face card. And sometimes you smile just for somebody, just to deceive somebody else that you are happy. But the point is, the real you is somewhere inside there and is directing the whole show. So that's the design, form, purpose. The designer is God. Only God could make you as you are. Only God could make a tree, the song says. Now, any questions on that? I pause for a minute, give you time to question. Nobody even questioned my meeting Jesus Christ as a person and talking with him for 7 months. You don't question that? You believe that?
Could you talk more about when you said Satan came to talk to you, and just in showing the difference of between hearing the voice of God and the voice of God?
Yes, well, I can give you two instances. One, I generally get up as a young man, you know. I get up at 3 o'clock in the mornings to pray. Best time to pray before I get to work. So I got up this morning, and I was awake. I wasn't asleep. And then I heard something like this. It was an intelligent knocking, but it was right on the head of my bed. And I listened. So the next time it started, I grabbed the head of the bed and started. And then I heard a voice. Now this voice sounded exactly like the same voice that I'm used to talking to Jesus. And the voice said, "My son." And I said, "Yes, Lord." And the voice began to talk to me. But the voice was telling me a lot of things about all the brethren in the group. And it was bad things, you know, what someone is doing and what someone is not doing. But I was engrossed in it, so I jumped up to get my pen. I didn't want to miss any of that now. Like, the Lord is telling me great revelations about people's business. And I got the pen to write. And when I got the pen, a great voice shouted, "Satan, you're a liar from the beginning." I said, "Oh, God." Because I thought it was God I was completely taking. And I said, "God, why did you do this to me?" In other words, why did you allow Satan to come and talk to me? And he said, "Why did you sit down for half an hour listening to the devil and not know that it is the devil?" And I was smitten right in here. And you know why? I wanted to be the great pastor. That ambition was in me to be able to go in the congregation and say, "I know about your business, and I know about your business, and I know about you, and I know about..." And that spirit in me was not God. It was a highway for Satan to come in. And what he was telling me, really, it couldn't be God, because it was telling me like slander. It was more like slander about the other people's business, about who was not living right, and who was in fornication, whatnot. And I knew it was the devil now, and I repented for my sin Because had I not have that opening to him, he would not have deceived me. I would have found out. Another time, I was receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost, and the devil came in through the door behind me. I was kneeling like this with my back to the door, but yet I could see the door open. I mean, that must have been a vision. I could see the door open, and I saw this angel come and stand over me. Now, he offered me, I saw a vision of a big tent and all the cars parked around the tent. And he said, I will make you the greatest healer in the world. And, but my knees couldn't stay on the floor. It was boom, boom, knock. I mean, I couldn't, my body was kind of so, I don't know what, how would I describe it, brother?
Distressed,
trembling and trying to keep myself together and couldn't keep myself on my knees knocking on the floor. I had a very uncomfortable feeling. And I said, wait a minute. I just finished talking to Jesus and it was such a peace. I felt so good. I said, now, who are you that you come now with a message to me and then I can't even contain myself? If it's not God, I don't want it. And he just disappeared. And the peace and calm came back. The Lord began to speak to me again. So I knew then. I give you an example in history. If you read the Mormon book there by Joseph Smith, he said that he had an experience with God, and then he was walking out and he saw a man in the field and this angel in the field and whatever, and it knocked him down or something like that. But his experience was that he met a messenger of God first, and then Satan came and offered him something and he took it. Now, if I had taken what the devil offered me, only God knows what would have happened, you see, because he promised to give me, to make me the greatest healer in the world. And yet, when the power of God came on me, some mighty healings, that's how my ministry started. That's what made me to prove that God is really God, because healing just started. The dumb speak. Man had no tongue, got a new tongue in his mouth. This, that, the other happened, and it just kept on like that. And I can tell you, I've seen every healing that can be possible on earth. So that I know even AIDS has been healed in my ministry. So I really know that God can heal, but God does not heal everybody and every time and everything. Therefore, you couldn't go and put up yourself as a healer and say, I'm going to heal everybody. And all this crowd come, and the disappointment, maybe God doesn't want to heal one person in that crowd. Remember now, Jesus Christ went to the pool of Bethesda, and there were a lot of sick folk out there. And he walked past every one of them and went to one special man, because that he's preaching the gospel. That was God's will to heal that man that day. So I don't know if this helps, but that answers the question. Any more questions on that point?
So will God ever reveal you something in your brother? Like I guess I'm asking, what's the difference between discernment?
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. I can understand that. Now, God will never show me anything about you unless I am moving in God. I love you. It's going to make me sad. I'm going to pray for you. I'm going to stand with you. He never show me something to put you down. Yes. Your wife or your friend, your parents or whatever, if God ever shows them anything about you, it is to help you, to strengthen you. God knows how much they love you. And God will never tell a person. That is why in churches we have people getting up and having a dream that this sister and the other sister turn into cats and begin to scratch up everybody else in this congregation and that sort of thing, and it breaks up churches. It's not God, the devil. I give you an experience. One night we had a church down in Miami, and a woman was in charge. And she had a dream tonight that these three chairs, she saw three demons, three black demons sitting in those three chairs while she was ministering, all right? Well, she went to service the night and she was ministering, and those three chairs were empty. And she started ministering. And as she opened the Bible and started, there comes three, a sister, two sisters and a brother come through the door. And they happen to be black. And they walk and sat right in the three chairs. She said, no, let's dismiss the meeting right now. Huh? Let's dismiss the meeting right now. The sister got up. I mean, I'm talking about friends of mine, people we fellowship with. The sister got up and said, no, please, please. She said, God sent me here tonight with a special message to you. Please let me. Oh, no, 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 no. And the congregation split right down the middle. She picked up her Bible and her book and walked to the door, and some of the brethren went with her and some stayed. And the brethren were so hurt. They didn't know what she dreamt. She didn't tell them dream. So they said, well, let us just pray. And they started praying and asking God to help them and so on and so. And the door opened. And a woman came through the door with her son in a wheelchair. She said, the Lord told her to come here tonight that the brethren should pray for this child. But that the traffic was so heavy that she was late and she had just come. And the brethren got up and began to pray for the boy. The boy was totally healed, get up out of the wheelchair. Plan of God. Now, it was the devil that gave that sister that dream. And he wanted to break up the congregation. And you know, eventually, that sister continued following that spirit, and she went and bought an aeroplane. And she was flying up in Alaska in a storm. She died, crashed and died. But you know, these things have repercussions. I'm in the church for 60 years, and I've been able to see some rise and fall. So when I give you the experiences that I'm giving you, 60 years of experiences in the church. Now, did I answer the question? All right, is there another question now before we go any further? Question me on anything in your heart, and I tell you why. I function by a gift of the Spirit. It's a gift. It's not that I am great or anything. You see these books? They're the gift of the Spirit. What the Lord brings to me, I write. I'm here with you. I don't have a plan, a chart. I don't study what to tell you. I'm listening to the Lord speak to me. If you have a question and you ask me, the Lord will tell me the answer. If he doesn't tell me, I'll tell you, no, I don't know. But if I give you an answer, it's what I receive. Sometimes I get the answer before you ask it, and I realize that some of you have answers, but you're a bit questions, but you're a bit shy. Don't be shy. We are all children of God sitting down together talking about God's business, and I want you to respond. See? So God designed you for a purpose. You know, there is something else about this picture here, that the whole thing here all of this, it is involved with time. You only have a certain amount of time to bring forth the purpose of God in your life. Did you know that? Time is involved. God put you here for a special purpose and a special time. I want to tell you something more. Now, you are not like me or even these. You are a different generation of people entirely because you are at the end, the very end of the world. Personally, I believe that by the year 2008, your lives will be totally changed, completely changed. That America will be under attack and destruction. And the thinking of Americans will be entirely different from what we are thinking now. That certain circumstances have held back the situation. And even our boys down there in Iraq, they are holding back the destruction. But all that was coming west. And by this time, they would have almost completely destroyed America. But that God has America for a purpose, for this hour, for this time. We, the people of God, are the only hope for America. Do you hear me? We are the only hope for America. Now remember now, I spoke with Jesus for 7 months, from August the 3rd until February next year, from February the next year, you know, starting from the 7th on. And when he left me, he said, whatever you want, ask me, and I'll do it for you. So I do function from the Spirit of God by the Spirit. Check it out. If there's something on your heart, you ask me and see the answer that God would give you. I'm just telling you that to give you confidence so that you might know that God does have people here working for him, strengthening his people. People who don't work for money. I don't work for money. You know, I just work for God. People whose lives belong to God completely. You, he wants you too. Because it is only the people of God that are going to save the world. You know, I said to the Lord one day, I said, Lord, how man cannot destroy your world. I said, you build this world, no, but man, human beings cannot destroy it. He said, yes, they can. I said, but God, where is that in the Bible? He said, turn to Matthew chapter 24 and somewhere around verse 21, 23, and you see it. And it says, but for the elect's sake. He said, first of all, there will be such great tribulation on earth as never was before or after or never shall be. And he said, but for the elect's sake, no flesh would be saved. So, but for us, as a few people, and you are being called into the elect, but for that few people, the whole world would be destroyed. And think of it. If all the atom bombs in all the arsenals around the world should be let loose, it would poison the atmosphere. No flesh would be left alive. Believe you me, I have seen what one little leak from the Chernobyl plant occurred, and what it did all across Europe, even into England, they had to kill the sheep and the animals because they were filled with radiation. So that's just one little leak Now you consider 1,000 bombs going off in various parts of the earth. So you must understand that God is preparing a people who will be able to stop it by the word of God. The Bible says all power is given unto you in heaven and on earth. And he wants people who will be able to use the power of God and stop the devil, stop the destruction, stop everything. And all that is before Jesus comes. He said, immediately after the tribulation of these days shall the sign of the Son of Man appear in the heavens. So that means Jesus is coming after the destruction. And what God has shown me is that by the year 2008, there's going to be a great atomic war. And America will be involved in actual on our soil. So when you see the government talking about terrorists trying to plant bomb into the United States, try, please. Think about it. You know, I was walking on the streets of Chicago yesterday, and I said, my God, if an atom bomb should hit this city, millions would die. Can you imagine it? Just use your imagination. Have you ever seen the pictures of Hiroshima and Nagasaki? The people who dropped the bomb, they didn't know what would have happened, you know. It was as much as a surprise to them to see what happened. But now we are faced with the fact that this is the end of the world, and the only people who can save it are the Christians. My understanding, my estimation. Oh, yes. God has one time quickened us to save our country from the communists. We got up and prayed. The communists got up and shot down many of the ministers who prayed, but we had a 24-hour prayer. India was praying. We ministered in India. Africa was praying. Czechoslovakia, London, all over the world were praying, and America was praying, and we prayed and stopped them. All of a sudden, they just gave up. The communists just gave up. And we're back again having the same problem. I'm from Jamaica. We are having the same problem again. Gunmen, 13-year-old, 12-year-old, are just shooting down people on the street. And God has sent us back there to stop them again. And we're going to stop them by the power of prayer. It's the only hope. You see? And when we talk about prayer, we don't mean to go, oh, please, Lord, do, Lord, help us, Lord. That's not the prayer God wants. God wants you to say, thank you, Jesus. I am a son of God. You have given me power over the power of the enemy. And in the name of Jesus Christ, I command a deliverance for my people. That's the type of prayer you must pray. You must know that you are a son of God. You must know what God has done for you. You must know what the Bible says about you. You must know that the Bible said, if any man sin, he had an advocate with the Father. So that if you have sinned, all you have to do is just say, God, help me. And that's it. That's it. It's forgiven. God wipes it away, deliver you from sin. So, and that sons of God don't go and sin willfully. They might fall into sin. But God said, if you the man that is born again doth not commit sin. You know what commit means? Commit is an active verb. It's not a passive verb. That is, you fall into sin, that's passive. But you actually commit the sin, you deliberately do it, you plan it, you fix, that's not a son of God. When you are a son of God, you do not commit sin. Now, if we understand that, and we have no further questions, by the way, how is the time? What kind of time are we working on, brother? Can anyone tell me? We need to break.
It's 5 till 3.
It's 5 to 3 now.
Yeah. Like 4-ish. 4, 4:30.
Okay, so Would you like for us to show the lesson and then we have a time to discuss? All right?
Yeah.
Good, all right. So I'll go on a little more and get... All right. Now, this here. How are you going to bring forth all this? God walk in you, God talk in you. God is your... You are God's people and God is your God. The how of it is the thing. And the point is that the first step that you need to make is to believe it. You say, boy, but I did sin yesterday and I do... Cut that out. You know why? If any man sin, you have an advocate with the Father. No problem. You sin because you were born in sin, you're shaped in iniquities, your nature to sin. God wants to deliver you out of that nature. Right? Remember I told you who I was? I was a rabble-rouser, a fighter, person who, you know, if I didn't get a fight for a day, I would feel bad. You know, just sick. Sick with violence. And God delivered me. It wasn't easy. I can tell you some stories. It wasn't easy. I got saved, and I still had it in me. And I thought that when you get saved, you get deliverance from everything. Well, I'm going to show you on the board what happened to you when you get saved. I thought I was delivered. I wasn't delivered. I got deliverance from my sin and got the power to become sons of God. John chapter 1. Huh? John chapter 1, verse 12. As many as believe on him, what he gave them?
Power.
Power. Authority. The Greek says exousia. Authority. So now you have the authority to become a son of God. But then to become what? Romans 8, verse 14 tells you what you become. He said, those who are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. See? So it's simple. You are coming from having power to be led by the Spirit of God. Get up and said, God, I want you to lead me. I want you to lead me. And then you did wrong. The moment you did wrong, God tells you you're wrong. So the moment you find out you're wrong, you say, oh, Father, you use another scripture. You call to God for deliverance. Immediately you're delivered. Thank you, Jesus. And then you go and you make another mistake again. But you have got to learn that God will continually correct you, bring you to righteousness. And you will recognize your mistakes. You'll recognize when you're wrong, you see? All right. So, all right. Now, the Word of God is God. The Word of God is God. First of all, you get the Word of God in your mind. Then it gets into your heart. Then it becomes a part of you. Isn't that simple? It's three actions. Your mind is like the eastern gate of Jerusalem, where the king comes in through your mind, not your emotions. Now, if you see a preacher or anybody preaching to you and trying to stir up your emotions, he's doing wrong. He's coming in the wrong door. Don't allow. First of all, you can't do business by emotion. If you're going to do any type of business, please don't do it because, all right, I'm so sorry for you, so I'm going to give you at such and such a price. Or I'm going, no. Don't do business by emotion at all. Don't do business with God by emotion. When you do business with God, do it because the word of God says so and so and so and so and so and so. So by your word, I come to you, Lord Jesus Christ, and I command the deliverance. Yes. My brother was a sinner, my younger brother, and he was, it made me sick. He was at every dance. He was everywhere, and he was, a playboy, total playboy. And I saw him carrying on, and I went to God, and I said, God, my brother, I want him to be saved. And according to the power that you give me, I am commanding his deliverance, and I will not eat or drink until he is delivered. I mean, that means you're going to die. But it didn't mean that to me. It just meant that I was so intense that this is what I wanted, God, and I know you want him to be saved. So I stopped eating. And I stopped eating that week. Saturday, I am living 70 miles away from him. And in Jamaica, 70 miles is a whole day's travel. So I took transportation and went to Kingston to get it. Couldn't find him. There was nowhere I could find him. I was disappointed, so we had a meeting, a church meeting. We went to the meeting, we had a wonderful time. Came home disappointed, didn't see him Saturday night. Sunday, he came in. And the first thing he said, Mama, I'm saved. So, now God's word is always in three. Anywhere you find in the Bible that the Bible says so-and-so, you can find it three different places at least. Did you know that? All right. Now, the Lord does everything in threes, and I don't know why. I would not try to explain to you why. I asked God one day to tell me about the Trinity. And you know, there are some people who don't believe in the Trinity. So I asked God, I said, please tell me about the Trinity. And God said, yes, simply. He said, just look at yourself. He said, you are a spirit, you are a soul, and you are a body. And you can see the body, but you never said you are three people. You always say you are one person. And so is God. So God speaks his word in three, and he does everything in three. Now, this is my spirit. This is my soul. And this is my body. And God is coming down. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And the God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit speaks to my spirit so that my spirit might speak to my soul, and that my soul might manifest his will in my body. That is well understood, right? Now, so the Spirit of the Son of God sent the blood of Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit into my spirit. And my spirit communicates the blood to my soul, and my soul manifests God in my body, physically. All right. The question is, How can a man be a Christian and at the same time he has sin or evil in his soul? You can. And I tell you how it works. God could make you like the angels, and he could make you pure and holy without sin. But if he did, you would be a robot. God wouldn't have a son, he would have a robot. Are you with me? God wants people to willingly, willfully, deliberately fight their way to serve God, because you want God. And that's the Son of God. So here you are, you have a mind. You have a mind. And I'd better use something else. You have a mind, and you have emotions, and you have a will, and you have desires. That's your soul. Your soul has four compartments: mind, emotions, will, and desires. Now, God ministers to the mind. He does not minister through your emotions. The mind affects the emotions and affects the desires and the will, but God does not come through your back door. The emotions is your back door. When the devil wants to disturb you, he lets somebody come against you, hit you, say some word against you, disturb you. And so, now, when God comes into your mind, you're listening now and you start thinking. Your God comes into your mind, you have to allow it, what God say, to become part of you. Then it affects your emotions and your will and your desires. So there, inside here, we have what we call the heart. And the heart is the center of your being, your soul. That is, I think I want it, I will get it, I desire it, I think I want it, I will get it, and I feel good about it, the emotions. And it becomes part of you. And so that's how it's functioned. But there can be something in your mind that does not affect your emotions. You can block off your emotions. Your emotions can be blocked off here. And it does not come to the emotions, so that your emotions still might have sin in it. Feel your desires might have the wrong desire, sin, and so God keeps pumping life in. Now, when you talk about the blood of Jesus Christ, what do you think it is? Red plasma? red plasma? No. The peculiar thing is that I think the devil did not know about the blood, or else he would never have killed Jesus. The blood of Jesus Christ, remember now, when you have a child, the child has your blood, the child has your features, the child has your mind, your soul. You impart soul to a child when you bring forth a child into the world. And the child has his father's blood. So then, whose blood did Jesus have, since he had no earthly father? Huh? Whose blood did he have? It had to be God. That means pure, life, substance, pure energy, pure light, pure power. I want you just to let that soak in a while, because I'm going to cut off presently for you to add. He had pure life, pure power, pure energy inside of him. And that's why he wanted to get it out. Because once that energy was let out of his veins, it would be let go in our atmosphere, in our world, in our realm, and you could get it by faith. If you believe it, you have it. See what I mean? And this thing becomes, this energy, this life, this power, becomes a weapon. It does not only deliver your soul, but it is so powerful that it's a weapon that can be used outside there against the enemy. See? I remember we were in India, and the great spirit of death, Kali, attacked us. Amen? And the Spirit of God spoke to me and said, the blood. And when I spoke the blood of Jesus Christ, the blood came down in the room and slamming to the floor. The blood is not only a force that can deliver you from any problems you have. You have ancestral problems, you know. You're born with certain bent, and you have to fight against them and overcome them. How do you fight against them? The scripture said, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. So you have a weapon. Now, but the first thing the weapon is going to do is to cleanse your soul area, cleanse your mind from thinking evil. Sometimes people get addicted to pornography, and it becomes so awful that every time you think of a person's body. And you need to be cleansed of it. How do you get cleansed? The blood of Jesus Christ. It cleanses you so you never even remember to think that sort of thinking, that way. The emotions, you have certain feelings that drive you. It cleanses the emotion. It cleanses your desires and your will. And so you manifest Christ through your body, because the power passes through the soul into the body. You know, your body is such a servant. Last thought, before I leave it to question. Your body is such a servant. We were in it was a concert. And this magician came, and he took two chairs like this, and he put one there, and he put one here. And he said, will anybody volunteer? And my cousin, she was, you know? And she said, you can't do anything to me. I challenge you. And he said, all right. Lie down here, put one heel here, and put your head here. And he held her up, and he said, all right, you are a piece of board. And she didn't move. He said, all right. He took a newspaper, print on her, and tell somebody to stand on her. And the man stood up on her, and her head was there, and her feet were there, and the woman was as stiff as a board. And I said, my God. I wondered for years, what did it? Was it the man's power of his mind? You know what did it? Her mind. He made a suggestion to her mind, and her mind accepted the suggestion. And she became like a piece of board that a man could stand on her. And then when he did like this, and she got up, he said, I tell you, you couldn't do it. And the whole congregation laughed. The whole concert laughed, because she didn't even know. She was totally unconscious. So the power of the mind is something that is mighty wonderful, but in Jesus Christ it is even more powerful. Oh yes, it is even more powerful. We have seen whole nations change because somebody got up and prayed. You know, whole nation stopped certain things from happening. We were in Nigeria, and the Muslims attacked the church and killed 12 or 13 brethren, and they were, you know, just wild attacking the churches. And so the churches got together and said, let us arm ourselves. And you know what that would mean, civil war. Because if Christians are going to fight Muslims, I mean, it would be just war. And the Lord quickened me. I said, no. And I went on the radio and denounced it and prayed to God that God stop them. And it just broke up their organization. To this day, some of the brothers don't not so happy with me. Broke up their organization, stopped the war. It stopped the Christians from going to war with the Muslims. You have a great power in God. Whatsoever you desire, he said, ask, and it shall be given to you. Question. This is a lot to question about. It's about your spirit, your soul, and your body. I leave it now for question time.
In Ephesians, when it talks about the word of God being your sword, how does that work together with the blood as far as your weapons?
The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are mighty to the overthrow, pulling down a stronghold and so on. When you said it's a sword, is the scripture you were referring to? Well, you see, the power is not just by the word alone, but by the word, by the spirit. In other words, the word has to be by the spirit. Okay. Here it was. There were some men in the time of Jesus who were the sons of Sceva. And they thought by speaking the word that certain things would happen. So they went to cast out devils, and they started to speak the same word that Jesus could come out of them in the name of Jesus and whatever. And the demons came out and tore them to pieces. Said, Paul we know, and Jesus we know, but who are you? So you see, it's not just a word, abracadabra, or anything like that, that does it. It is by the Spirit. So it is a word by Spirit.
Well, the devil quoted Psalm 91 in Matthew 4.
You bet.
Perfectly.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it was good. He said he'd given his angels charge over you.
Oh, yeah. You remember that?
Put it against the stone.
The devil said to Jesus, and quoted Psalm 91, he said, God has given his angels charge over thee concerning thee, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. So jump off the pinnacle. And that would have been contrary to God. So you could see that it's not just the word. It has to be the word by the Spirit. I want you to be free to ask me a question about something that I didn't speak about. You know what I mean? You are free to go that way. If we have another time or another session, I want to talk to you about the church. The church is divided into three parts. You have Father, Son, Holy Ghost. You have spirit, soul, body. You have outer court, holy place, holy of holies.
Just as was talking to a guy once, and he said, I was talking about the tabernacle, and he said, well, there's a verse that says Christ divided, you know, did Paul baptize, and, or are you baptized in the name of Paul, it's Christ divided, and he just, would you just use the same example as the body?
No, Christ is not divided. That's why Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is one person. That's why you, spirit, soul, and body, are one person. And that's why the church, outer court, holy place, and holy of holies is one church. See, it's not, although there's seven different works of grace in that church, you see, and some only have one and some only have two, it's not divided as far as God is concerned. It's one church. He doesn't believe in two churches. So, like you say, I belong to Baptist, I belong to Methodist, I belong to Catholic. You are not moving as if God wants you to move because you're supposed to belong to God. Regardless of who, where you go to service, you're supposed to belong to God. Yes. I hope you're not intimidated in any way. Just get free.
You said that you thought something, that a war would start in 2008 here.
Yes.
Why?
That,
and why, is, okay. Why do you think now is the end?
Why? Okay. As I say, I've been with the Lord for 60 years, and I've been talking to the Lord. When I got saved first, God told me that America was going to be destroyed. And he said, I'm going to send you there one day, and you will meet some of my people. And so in the year 1969, we came to the United States. And we began to meet the people of God. Peculiar thing is that now the people of God who we are meeting are the children of the people who we met, and some of them grandchildren. So although we met them and we thought they were the people, it so happened that their children are the people. Okay. Then in 1970, I was in Fort Lauderdale, and I went to sit, I was mowing the lawn, and I felt the Spirit of God call me to go inside, so I sat down, looking down like this with my hand, looking down, and praying. And suddenly I saw the door open. And I didn't turn to look. I just felt that if I turned to look, the messenger would disappear, but I knew it was a messenger from God coming to me. He came and he stood right before me, and I saw his feet. They were gartered. I don't know if you understand what I mean by gartered. You know how that ancient runners used to be. They would have the garters like this. Their feet was, and then they had on this running shoes. And he was standing before me. I'm looking down at this man's feet, standing before me. I don't want to rise up because I don't want him to leave. And so he put one piece of paper into me like this. He said, read that. And I struggled. I couldn't read it. It was written from the top right down to the bottom. And it was an illegal size paper. And it was a man's handwriting, but it was not English. I couldn't read it. And he said, never mind. He pulled it away from me. And he said, and that is the past. He said, you don't need to read it, it is the past. And he said, read this. And when I tried to read it again, I couldn't read, but it only had two lines at the top. And the whole thing was empty. And the whole paper was empty. And he said, that is the tribulation. And for years I struggled, because the church teaches that 7 years is tribulation. And I couldn't find in the Bible, any place in the Bible that told me that the tribulation was 7 years. And yet I did not know when the tribulation was. And eventually over my 60 years, God revealed to me little by little that the tribulation is 40 years of tribulation. And that when he showed me that the tribulation had started from 1968, it should have started in 68 when the Jews were attacked and you had that war, that 7 days war, and that's the time it should have started, but God blocked those 2 years off. And it started in 70, and so it was 38 years left. So from 68 to 2008 is 40 years. I still didn't make, I didn't get it. And I went on for years and years again until in the year, maybe 2000, somewhere there, the Spirit comes again to me and showed me and told me point blank, I saw Jesus again. And he said, in the year 2008, there'll be a great atomic war. And he'll tell me more about it. So when I get the rest of it, I'll tell you, but I want to warn you as young people that your lives are out there. Put your life in Christ. For it is only in Christ that there is safety. There's no place that you could run to and said, I want to be here. And you'll be in Christ. Because Christ is going to lead you and lead your family and lead your life exactly where you ought to be at the time when you should be there. That is how I got it. See, it was just a direct revelation from the Lord. And I believe it with all my heart. Yes, the 3.5 years is we have been wondering, you know, whether the 3.5 years will start before the tribulation or after the tribulation. But all I can tell you that I know for sure that the sons of God will come forth. If you look at your Revelation, imagine that. I didn't open the Bible. If you look at Revelation chapter 11, and verse 3, somebody want to read that for me?
And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth.
Good. Now, all right, he says that he will give power to his two witnesses, that is to the Spirit and the Word. The Spirit and the Word in human form. The Spirit and the Word coming forth in human beings. That's the two witnesses. Some people say the two witnesses are Elijah and Moses. But you know why they look like Elijah and Moses? Because Moses was a man of the Word. He was the law. And Elijah was a man of the Spirit. So it was the Spirit and the Word coming together into you, into the body of Christ that he is talking about. He said he'll give power, but you notice that verse 2 says that the court which is without the temple, leave out, measure it not, for it is given unto the Gentiles, and the holy city shall they tread underfoot 42 months. So for 3.5 years, they are going to destroy the Christians who are not in the Holy of Holies. You know, I'm going ahead of the teaching because your Christians are in three different areas. Okay, let me explain to you. Your spirit is in a different frequency, higher frequency than your soul. But your soul is still a spirit and it is in a higher frequency than your body. Your body is in the lowest frequency so that it physically manifests here. But you nevertheless, you still have a soul and a spirit that are in a higher realm. Well, the church is situated just like that. The church is in three different realms. You'll find some people who are in the church who are in what we call outer court Christians. They believe God. They are born again. But they do not believe in walking by the Spirit. They don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They don't believe in moving on further with God. In other words, somebody said, I haven't got saved on such and such a time. And they remain there. Now, anything that remains static dies. You have to progress in God. So what you are today, you should be better than what you were yesterday. And so there is a progression. So you move from one realm of faith and belief into a higher realm of faith and belief in a higher realm, until you come into a place where you be like Christ. Now, so this speaks of the outer court Christians, that is Christians who just, they have not given themselves wholly to God. In other words, let me put it in terminology that you can understand. They are born again. Jesus is their Savior. But Jesus is not their Lord. You must have heard this preach in your churches. You must have Jesus as Lord. He's your Savior. The next move is to have him as Lord. And so many of us have Jesus as our Savior. We don't have him as our Lord. And those people, they will be exposed. God says here, they will be given over that the Gentiles trample them on the feet. Amen. Arrest them, do all kinds of things, put them in prison, destroy them. But of course, they will gain heaven anyhow. But he said there's another set of Christians who will be victorious, who I will give power unto my two witnesses. That power there, brother, it is dunamis. Yes, yes, the explosive power, to do the thing, okay? I give you authority, you come and you join the police force, and you get the authority, you get the badge, you get your gun, you get your everything, you are a policeman. But then you meet a burly, 7-foot man, and you want to take him in. Amen. And amen. You can use your authority, but it needs some force, because that guy is resisting you. It's like the little lady there that went to arrest this guy, and the guy beat her up and take away her gun and shoot the people. It's you have the authority, but you need power to exercise your authority. And so you find that this is what is happening. He said, no, I will give you that power. So the church will have a power that we never had before. But the timing to answer your question, you think it's your question, the timing of the power must, Lord tell me, he will give the church the power to stop the war. So if it is in the middle of the war, if the war starts 2008, and it's a war that's going to continue to 2009, we don't know when, but it is in that period of time that we're going to get the power. When you see the war start, say, Lord God, give me the power. Because at least you should have it, you should be there, ready before. But it won't be too late. And so this is what I'm saying to you. You need to believe the word of God, but it is God that makes you believe the word. I don't expect you to swallow it. Please don't. Unclean animals swallow before they chew the cud. The Bible said clean animals chew their cud. You know what that means? It means that when you take the thing into your mind, you think over it, you put it down, you check it up in the scriptures. Is this man right? What is he saying? You check it in the scriptures, you research. You know, just like you go to school and you research things. God wants you to research. God does not want you just to swallow, because when you just take it and swallow, you don't even know. You believe blindly. And that's how we get cults. People become in a cult because they just believe what the leader says and run with it. But God wants you to get down there and go into it. That's why I want you to question me. You know, question everything I say. Question it. You're not in any trouble to question it. You're not going against God to question. God wants you to question everything. He said, clean animals chew their cud. You know that? Yeah. Bring it up back. Regurgitate. Eat again. Regurgitate. That's not pretty. But amen. So praise be to God. That's what we are talking about. And so I want you to question the whole thing. This is your outer court. This is your holy place. And this is the Holy of Holies, where the Spirit is.
Going back to how you talk about the spirit, soul, and body with the human, can you talk more about the relationship of in our soul with our mind, emotions, will, and desires, and our heart? Just go into a little more detail as far as...
Okay. Here is the thing. You are twice, you are two times spirit. Therefore, everything you do, every single thing you do, it is caused by some spiritual motion. That is, the spirit here is trying to overshadow your soul with truth. But generally, there's a barrier here. See, there's a barrier between spirit and soul that sometimes you don't get what is in the spirit. The spirit has something there. And there's a barrier between here. That's why you have barriers in the tabernacle. See? Now, the spirit is ministering life to the soul. But the soul must accept the life. That's why you have to accept Jesus Christ in order to be saved. And it is so powerful that you don't really know how powerful it is. I mean, a person comes here and he says a nice word to you and says you are beautiful and so on and so on. You start feeling good. All the beautiful hormones begin to flow in your body. He just told you through your ears. You see? And so, but if he comes and he curses you, and anger starts, immediately, hormones begin to rush into your body. And I remember times when I was angry and I go, yeah? The guy just said something to you. So it's a word that you got in your ears, that you took in your mind, and your mind begin to minister to the rest of your soul, bam, into your body. So your body is a servant, a very, very, very obedient servant. And everything a person does in their body, it comes from the mind. Now, you can block off the spirit. And when you block off the spirit, you can have demon ministering. The demons minister. See, the demons minister actually mostly to the emotions, but he also ministers to the mind. And so once your soul is like a pivoted door. If you open to God, no devil can come in. You open to the devil and it stops God. See, so that is why it is so important to learn to think. You have to learn to think. For instance, this brother was going for a business meeting, and a lot was hanging on it. You're going for your exam. He said, I said to him, okay, you start thinking about the blood of Jesus Christ. Just think about the beating that they gave him on his back, the blood flowing down his back. Think about the crown of thorns with the blood flowing down here. And as you keep thinking about that, you go into the meeting with that in your mind and see what happens. He went into the meeting, and the people just said, "We give you everything you want. What is it can we do?" And he was shocked. Everything just went. Because what spirits see, a spirit look at you, what do you think he sees? You think he's seeing your beautiful features? What he's seeing is light or darkness. If you have dark things in your mind, he sees the darkness and he zeroes in on it. And so if you understand we are living in a spiritual world, it's not all natural. Everything that happens in the natural, it's some spiritual source, some spiritual reason. And if you can fix the thing in the spirit, the natural will work. You try it. You go for your examination and start thinking about the blood of Jesus Christ and see what happens. You just sweep right through. Because the blood is an energy. It's a life force. It's not blood. It's not red plasma. It's a life force that is in this room. And the moment you start believing, it starts coming down into you. And it changes you. See what I'm saying? And remember, it's a very old head that is talking to you. Someone who has gone through it, in my words. Your age, I was everybody's age in here. Isn't that wonderful? I know I am only 83. And you won't catch me up. Amen. Praise be to God. Yes, I want you just to think of what I'm saying and question it. Did I answer that more, or you want more? Should I go on? You can teach about this spirit, soul, and body all day. See, because you can come to the point where you have ancestral endowments from your parents, from your grandparents, from what over there, you get all kinds of things zeroing in on you. And some people say, "I can't help it because I have this and that and that." You can't help it. This is the problem. God gave us the power to become sons of God. No longer sons of John Brown or Tom Stokes or whatever your name, but sons of God. And when you become a son of God, then you begin to follow God and not your inclinations. I love questions, though. Question it. Question everything that I say, for you know, that's where the life comes in. That's where you get your life.
Can you tell us a little bit more about like the 7 months and stuff? Like, kind of like when you came and talked to you and stuff?
All right. One day, you know, it began to talk to me about the Word of God first. And it was the Word of God that first I began to believe the Word of God. This Bible is the Word of God. There's only one little problem, that man translated it from one language to another. And whenever you speak something in one language and somebody translates it to another language, it carries less force. Right? So then that we who begin to study the Word had to go back to the Greek and the Hebrew to somewhat catch a grasp of what did God mean when he said so. That's what you, exegesis, that's what you need. What did he mean when he spoke? And as you you realize then that this is the basis of the truth. Unfortunately, you have many translations. So therefore, some of the translations give you less of the truth than others of the translation. So I use the King James because it is the closest. For instance, I give you a word here. It says, he that is born of God committed not sin. So this old time English, why do we use this old English? I used to be an English teacher. You have no tense in English to actually explain committed. Committed means that you committed yesterday, you commit today, and you have the intention of committing tomorrow. You see what I mean? It is an active verb, and it shows both past, present, and future at the same time, with an inbuilt intention. That if I said committing, which is a continuous tense, it would not carry the force. But committed means that he commits and he commits and he commits, and it is intention to commit. You are not born of God. You're not born again. If there's a sin, if you continue in sin like that. So that's what it means. Okay. Now, I then, you want to hear more about my talking to Jesus. Let me see. One day, early in our association, he came in the room and he was very much upbeat. Now, when I say God, Jesus is upbeat, when he comes in, you feel sap. That's the only way I can explain it. You just feel the energy and alive. He's like he's pleased with you. And he said to me, anything you want, ask for it. Oh, what am I going to ask for? And I was really thrown for a loop. I never thought of it, that God Almighty would be asking me to ask him for anything I want. You know? Well, the first thing that occurred to me was, he said, Lord, I'd never seen anybody healed. I want to see somebody healed. He said, well, you got it. And I left the room. I said, Lord, I have to go try it out. I don't know how you feel, but if someone gave you a powerful piece of equipment, wouldn't you want to try it out right away? So I ran down the street, and I saw a man and knocked at the door and asked the man, is there anybody in here that is sick? And the man looked at me with a wry smile, you know, like he feels that I'm gone a little bit. So he said, well, no, we don't have anybody here that is sick, but there's a woman down the end of the last house on the street. Said she went to the doctor and she's dying. Thank you. And I mean, I don't know if I was running because I was young, but I could not walk. I ran down to that house, knock on the door. The guy peeped, and I actually forced my way in. I said, please forgive me. I just want to pray for your wife. And I saw her. And believe you me, she was covered from head to toes, white sheet over her like a dead person. And I went and laid my hands on the white sheet and said, in the name of Jesus Christ, be healed. And she threw off the cover and sat up in the bed. And I'm looking at her and I said, well, I turned to him and said, was she sick? And she laughed and said, you don't believe, do you? Honestly, I didn't know what to believe. It's the first healing I had seen in my life. And she got up, she went to the sink, got a drink of water, drank, went back into her bed, and sat down looking at me. So I asked the husband, he said yes. He said, she was given up by the doctor for dead because there was no cure for her and there was no hope. And so I just said thank you and went out, and believe me, brother, after that day, I mean, it was just one after the other. People being healed. So this one woman, this night, they called me. I rushed up to the house. Her eyes were turned over and she was gone. So I lay hands on her. And when I lay hands on her, I heard somebody behind me speaking to something and commanding the thing to get out of her. So I felt bad, really, that somebody had come in and take over the prayer from me. So the woman rise up, and I look around, and there was nobody. I realized the thing was coming out of my own mouth. And I was talking in another language. So I was pretty much ashamed, because, you know, I was the accountant on the farm, one of the accountants on the farm, and we were in government things, and, you know, we were officers and things like that. So we're supposed to behave a certain way. I mean, I don't know if in America it's like that, but in the British countries, officers behave differently from the commoners.
We would like to make available to you the following books. Nuggets for the Needy, a collection of spiritual encouragement for the hungry Christian, by Mavis DuCille. Place in my hands the wonderful key. The Pattern reveals to us the typology of the Tabernacle of Moses into biblical instructions for our time. The Book of Revelation, a three-volume set of one of the most extensive and in-depth commentaries ever written. To order, write to Sunlight Gospel Association, Post Office Box 8237, Port St. Lucie, Florida 34985, or visit our website at slgospel.com. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything